We're going to move now to a third session, and you may ask yourselves, which I'm doing already myself, how do we differentiate this session from the previous one? But just think that we have a fantastic set of panelists, and we're going to get insight from them on several trade initiatives regarding clean energy technologies, and then the lessons that we can draw from what has been done and what we can do going forward. Maybe just a couple of words from my part on that. We have touched upon a number of issues this morning, particularly this morning and in the afternoon panel just now. In the context of trade agreements, we keep referring to APEC, and then on bilaterals, we keep bringing up EU-Singapore, although there's also the EU-Canada and EU-Vietnam agreements that are also interesting from the perspective of clean energy technologies. And then, of course, the plurilateral agreement of the plurilateral agreements in the WTO, in the context of the WTO, both the ITA and ITA2, as well as the EGA. There's much more. We have done some of the sort of the review work, looking at what are the provisions that are interesting from a clean energy technologies perspective in RTAs, and we have some of that work published in our websites. And so there's quite a bit more. There's also, obviously, and we have sort of touched upon it, but without talking about particularly ways forward, the various provisions in various WTO agreements, and then the possibilities that we may have to for reform or to look for better implementation of those provisions through the committees in the WTO or other or other forms. I think it was Ingrid this morning that mentioned that the low-hanging fruit possibilities of liberalization unilaterally. One of the issues looking at the landscape on barriers on clean energy technologies that it's obvious to everybody is the proliferation of nuisance tariffs. So these are tariffs that are that may seem small, but in a world of value chains as goods cross borders get more elaborated, cross borders again or cross several jurisdictions before they get to their final destiny of deployment, those nuisance tariffs become more and more important, they accumulate, and so they are an issue. They also, as we have seen from the experience of the application of punitive duties, for instance, remedies, anti-dumping in the case of remedies, we also know that there is such sensitivity in this kind of goods that competitiveness can be really affected by tariffs, even if they seem to be that low. So again, that question of an effort to reduce those tariffs is an important one, and in a world of value chains, it doesn't escape anybody's imagination that unilateral action is probably what is more reasonable in many ways in that respect. Then there's very wicked issue of local content requirements or domestic content requirements, as the Indians call it. There's probably a need to really look very carefully at the various ways in which these requirements take form in different settings, and then the policy objectives that they carry. And then with that in mind, think about how to tackle them. And so I think the response that they are, the simple response that they're prohibited under WTO agreements is not satisfactory. We've done a review of local content requirements, and it's widespread. Their use is widespread. And so I think that there must be a way forward. Some of the work that we have done in the context of the E15 look at ways in which some of those measures could be converted into measures that are WTO compatible and could pursue the same objectives that they're designed to pursue. And so that kind of effort is probably necessary also from an analytical perspective to help countries in their policy reform efforts. So I think I'm going to stop here. I'm just, I think one other thing I wanted to rescue is perhaps this notion of thinking about barriers as something that involves goods, services, and investment, and I'd say probably intellectual property as well. Already in the EU, Singapore, you see an integration of trade and investment. You see provisions that are related to investment. This morning, Ambassador Fried from Canada expanded a bit on this as well. We just heard something from Tim Richards in the same sense. It seems that in the current context of talks on trade, where there is more and more awareness of the need to integrate trade and investment, that makes all sense to also do more analytical work in that respect, try to understand what frameworks on investment and measures on investment, how they affect trade and the other way around, how trade measures and trade policies affect investment in the field of clean energy technologies, and then how to integrate, again, the solutions going forward. So again, I'll stop there and then turn to our panel. We're going to start with Luis Adolfo Fernandez, who is a counselor at the Mission of Costa Rica to the WTO. And Luis Adolfo will talk about his country's experience. This morning, we already touched upon a paper that we sponsored from ICTSD looking at some of that experience. And so, do you have the floor, Luis Adolfo? Go ahead. Just a quick word before you take the floor. I think I was told by someone that the reason we didn't have many questions in the previous sessions may be because people feel intimidated sometimes when these sessions are broadcasted. This session is not being broadcasted, it's being recorded. So don't feel intimidated, and it will be the recordings of the presentations and the panels will be posted in the website in a week or two, but we never post the recordings on questions and answers, so don't feel shy. So.
Thank you, Mr. Melendez, and thanks to the ICTSD and the World Energy Council for inviting us to this event. I would like to first apologize on behalf of Ambassador Cedeño, who was scheduled to be with you this afternoon and deliver this presentation. Unfortunately, he had a last-minute call from San Jose, and he had to travel today, so I'm going to deliver this presentation on his behalf. So basically, we would like to touch base. Obviously, we're going to mention some experiences from Costa Rica, but we would like to focus our presentation on the linkage between trade and climate change and on how can trade policy contribute to implement the Paris Agreement, including through the trade liberalization of clean energy technologies. So basically, we do believe that liberalization of environmental goods and services is definitely one of the most important international trade policies that may help achieve climate change mitigation. Negotiations, as you know, on this subject has already been handled, both in the WTO and more recently in the environmental goods agreement negotiations on reducing or eliminating tariffs on these goods. Definitely should reduce their price and therefore facilitate their deployment. So we do believe that this is an important aspect to highlight. Unfortunately, as you know, and it has been already mentioned in earlier interventions, the EGA negotiations are stalled for the moment since participants could not reach an agreement last December. It is unclear at this point when negotiations are going to be resumed, but at least from our side, and we are participants of the EGA negotiations as well, we remain positive that this is just a temporary impasse. Negotiations were actually quite advanced at the moment they got suspended, with most technical work already done. So basically, it is the moment to take political decisions at a higher level in order to resume negotiations and push for a final deal. So in these regards, we do believe that the leadership of major players is key to try to resume negotiations. Let's recall, though, that the liberalization of trade may be pursued by means other than plurilateral trade negotiations. Elimination of tariffs to clean technologies may also be achieved domestically or unilaterally. For example, it is worth mentioning that some countries' national determined contributions in the Paris Agreement included the reduction of import duties of goods, such as hybrid and electric cars or renewable energy equipment. It would be very valuable to pursue further research regarding the role of trade in NDCs. The ICTSD recently hosted an event related to trade and new climate regime in which this issue was tackled in the presentation made by Ms. Clara Brandy, which is a senior researcher of the German Development Institute. According to Ms. Brandy's presentation, 45% of all countries' climate contributions made a direct reference to trade. 22% included specific trade elements that are geared towards fostering mitigation, and almost all contributions included references to elements that are in one way or another related to trade. So it is quite clear from our point of view that trade is an important element in countries' contributions to climate change mitigation, and it should be further analyzed. It is our understanding that the ICTSD is currently doing some additional work with Ms. Brandy, and we definitely look forward to their results. Costa Rica, alongside with other countries like Korea, Canada, Chinese Taipei, and Mexico, are also organizing a trade and climate change workshop, which will be held back-to-back to the next Committee of Trade and Environment of the WTO in June. And hopefully, we will be able to go deeper on this subject. So that was just a small commercial. Anyway, we do, as I mentioned, liberalization of trade and environmental goods is an important policy option that could be pursued in order to mitigate climate change. But there are other options as well that we would like to highlight. And some of them have already been mentioned this morning by Ambassador Fried, for example. So I'm just going to go into four of them. The first of them is the introduction of carbon pricing mechanisms. This is an important option that could be used to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. It has already been used at domestic levels, being the EU emission trading scheme, the first and most wide-ranging trading scheme dating back to 2005. However, the idea of setting a global carbon market under a larger participation scheme, or more recently to pursue climate clubs, are also interesting options. Technical requirements is something that also has been widely mentioned in this session's presentations. We do believe technical requirements could serve as a perfect complement of trade liberalization and environmental goods and services. Climate change-related technical requirements may take the form of maximal level of emissions of energy consumption, or they may specify standards for energy efficiency for both products and production methods. E-commerce, this is one element that also was mentioned this morning by Ambassador Fried, and we do believe it's a kind of a new idea and it's important to mention it as well. We believe that widespread use of e-commerce as the more efficient way to bring together producers and consumers may indirectly reduce emissions, since consumers will not need to physically move in order to search and obtain products they are seeking. Therefore, the promotion of e-commerce may prove to be a valuable tool that merits further consideration. Finally, we would like to talk about a little bit about private investment, which we already heard about some private actors in this presentations this morning as well. In many cases, private sector initiatives that favor the development of clean technologies and reduction of emissions have proven to move faster than the implementation of trade policies, and therefore also deserve closer attention and support from government and consumers. There are many examples that we can mention. Of course, you know, everybody knows, for example, the cutting-edge technology that have been developed by companies like Tesla in developing battery packs for efficient electric vehicles. Back home in Costa Rica, we do have a very nice example to mention by a company that's called Ad Astra, which is a Costa Rican-based company that is based in the province of Guanacaste, which is one underdeveloped region of Costa Rica, but still, you know, it does very nice research. Now, right now, it's currently developing a hydrogen-based energy storage technology that would store hydrogen obtained by electrolysis and be used as an alternative fuel. This would provide Costa Rica with the opportunity to transform its energetic and transportation system into self-sufficient ones, independent from the import of fossil fuels. So this technology is currently being tested to operate hydrogen fuel cell electric buses, public buses in the province of Guanacaste, where the company is located. So if this technology is actually developed further, it could definitely transport our whole transportation system, which is heavily dependent on the importation of fossil fuels. So finally, it is worth mentioning as well that counting with reliable carbon emission statistics are essential for formulating responses to climate change, and therefore studies like the ones done by the OECD on embedded CO2 emissions in trade and value added may prove to be very valuable in helping us identify further opportunities. So in conclusion, we would just like to say that trade liberalization on environmental goods is key to achieve climate change mitigation, but we cannot solely rely on international efforts in these regards. Climate change continues to be a threat that requires attention, and we need to be more creative and foster alternative solutions to this problem. We have already mentioned a few. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Phil, and thank you for being very concise and precise. Also for the recommendations for further work. I'd like to now turn immediately then to Edgar Richard Ubelho de Rosaldo, who has been from the private sector, a participant in the past 25 years on the FTA negotiations and other negotiations of Mexico, including most recently in the TPP, in the Pacific Alliance, but also several of the bilaterals a hat from the private sector in the Coordinadora Empresarial de Comercio Exterior, is that it? Which is the public-private council that advises the government on the negotiations. So Edgar, you have the floor.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Melendez, and thank you to the ICSTD and to the World Energy Council for inviting the Mexican chapter of the World Energy Council, which I'm representing. And I will try to briefly explain the relationship between NAFTA, North American Free Trade Agreement, the TPP, the Trans-Pacific Agreement, and energy and clean energy. So it is a not easy task in the few minutes I have. But let me start with the Mexican history. We had about three decades of closed economy, protectionism, and finally we opened our economy by joining the GATT in the mid-80s of the last century. And then we negotiated the North American Free Trade Agreement. It is unclear whether this was a Mexican suggestion to the US and Canada that already had a free trade agreement, or if we were invited by the US. But anyway, we joined them and formed this very important for us free trade agreement. And later we negotiated others between 1995 and 2015, other 11 free trade agreements with 44 countries. Now, NAFTA is by far the most important one. And the reason we joined the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement for us was because it was the renegotiation of NAFTA and other free trade agreements like the one we had with Peru and another one with Chile. And the TPP was signed by 12 countries. Now, there are two graphs. Yes, they are there. The one to the left is the destination of Mexican exports, and the one to the right, the origin of Mexican imports. Without looking very much at the small numbers, the US means 81%, over 81% of our exports, and about 47% of the origin of our imports. The other members of our free trade agreement, or TPP group, are very small, as you can see, just tiny figures there. And then others outside the TPP and, of course, outside NAFTA mean only 13.8% of our exports and 42% of our imports. And under the imports, I must say that about half of that or more comes from China. We don't export very much to China, but we import a lot from China. So, being the TPP, about 11% of the world population, about 26% of the foreign trade in the world, and 37% in the gross domestic product, and also 34% of foreign investment, foreign direct investment. And being NAFTA, a large part of this, it was clear for us that whatever happened in the future relationship of Mexico with foreign countries, NAFTA and TPP would be fundamental. Later I will say that things may be changing. But let me explain, because it has been discussed this morning and this afternoon. NAFTA, TPP, and the energy sector. We are using the local content requirement as a main instrument for this. And this goes apparently against all that has been said in this meeting. Now, why is this so? Well, in Mexico, we have the oil industry and the electrical power. They were only in monopoly, only state-owned enterprises were allowed to do this. Recently, we had a constitutional amendment, and now we are opening the energy sector to private investment. But it was not a privatization of the sector, because Pemex and CFE, the state-owned companies, remain there competing with the private companies that will join us. And when NAFTA was negotiated, we found that Canada had private companies in the oil sector, and although they have state-owned enterprises in the electrical power generation and distribution and so forth, they didn't cover the electrical sector in government procurement for several reasons. And the United States has mostly private companies, both in the oil and in the power sector. And Mexico had only government enterprises. So Mexico was required to open to international tenders, national treatment, to the US and Canadian companies, but we were not receiving the same treatment in their procurement, because they were either government but not covered by the free trade agreement, or private companies not required to do the tender, international bidding, and so forth. And so, to compensate part of this difference, it was accepted that Mexico could use local content requirements, but designed with two or three very important points. One, they're not for every procurement of those companies, state-owned companies. They're only used if it is a major project financed by a private group, not by the government. And then we can only use about usually 25, exceptionally up to 40% of local content requirement, and never so that the main contractor has to contract a Mexican for all its procurement. So we keep a balance between imports and local production. And this way, it is quite complicated, but I could explain it if somebody is interested later. This way, there is no race in cost. It has been proven that there is no cost problem. On the other side, this was so clear to everybody that the TPP recently accepted exactly the same conditions we had negotiated 1991-1992 in NAFTA. So it has been accepted by the other members of TPP, and this is basically the way it is being operated. And one last comment, uncertain future. Well, as you know, Mexico has been singled out as an enemy. I'm speaking as a private Mexican citizen. Mexico has been singled out as an enemy, and I'm on the wrong side of the wall that is supposed to be built. I won't pay for it, but it is quite a problem, and now being serious, because Mexican, as I showed it before, Mexican economy depends on the U.S., and if NAFTA is to be renegotiated and perhaps abandoned, and TPP has been already, today they said it was dormant, it has been abandoned by the U.S., we don't know what will happen with all our efforts and free trade agreements, and clean energy is also not anymore apparently a priority in the U.S., So I was wondering what I was going to say to you this afternoon if there are no more free trade agreements and there is no need for a clean energy. But we hope that things will improve and that we somehow will go on with the direction we had been following for a couple of decades. And that's where I stop.
Thank you very much, Edgar. That's very rich and, again, very helpful to hear it. My own very brief reaction to your last comment is that I being an optimist and having been in this trade business now for longer than I'd like to think, my hope is that, and expectation is that we will move into what I call aggressive competitive liberalization in the next few years as a result of the policies that we're seeing coming from Washington and from other places, rather than what other people see as protectionism. And but let's see. And part of our job there it is to try to move in that direction. And on renewable energies, we will also see more rather than less, again, trade and activity. And so again, for all those reasons, all this is very pertinent at this time and to have this discussion, I think. So thank you for that. I'll move immediately to our next speaker, and that's Neil Lawlor. And Neil is with the European Commission DG Trade, which says just about everything before he tells us his own views. Huh?
Okay, thank you. And thanks for pronouncing my name right. Everybody pronounces it Nile, but it's actually Neil. So it's, anyway, so thank you. When I was invited to come, I looked at the title of the session and it said, you know, lessons learned. And I think that was covered a bit in speakers before in terms of, you know, what's the lessons learned from the last few years. And one of the items was to say, well, it's essential to have a multi-pronged approach so that you don't put all your eggs in one basket. Or, you know, it was also, are we just looking at green tech or, you know, because the FTA, the EU FTA, with Singapore was mentioned several times, but then other people said it's important to be consistent, have proper coverage, continuity over certain years so that you have investment. And I think that's what I wanted to approach. I had a few slides. I don't know if who's got the button. Do I have the button? I just wanted to, in terms of the coherence and coverage aspect. In the EU, we have this energy union strategy, which is predominantly internal. But as a Canadian colleague this morning said, the internal kind of structures or provides the framework for the external policy. And in November, the EU published a whole series of proposals, legislative proposals, that were in total with supporting documents over 4,000 pages long. From biomass to retail electricity to green tech to... So this kind of sets the tone. And in the background, we also have a resource efficiency strategy from several years ago, which is also highly relevant to green trade. And of course, this all, this, I don't know, focus on coherence was kind of brought together last year in trade strategy, Trade for All, where on energy in particular, the objectives is to focus on renewables, energy efficiency, but also on security of supply, access, level playing field in its trade deals. And also in the energy union, that the ambition to be in renewables to be world number one in terms of capacity, but also to export expertise. So it's ambitious and broad and coherent and all these things, hopefully. So that's what I wanted to, as a kind of, it's not so much a lesson learned, but it's more the kind of European approach. In terms of the multi-pronged approach that was suggested this morning, well, we're all familiar with the WTO and the Energy Charter Treaty, and they've kind of, they provide a very good basis, but not as lot as a huge amount has happened over recent years. And of course, you're all familiar, probably more familiar than I am, with the EGA, because I focus on energy and not environmental goods per se. But of course, it's very important and ongoing. My area is predominantly at the moment on bilaterals. So our focus in the past has been on a kind of two different types. So on the deep and comprehensive FTAs, we're focusing on classical energy like piped gas, oil, somewhat electricity. And then the more recent ones, so we mentioned on Singapore, but there was also Korea on green goods. There was Vietnam is more recent. And there's been a lot more focus on renewables, energy efficiency, and then all this other discussion we had in the previous session on conformity and a bit more deeper than the old style classical. And of course, there's enforcement as well, which was mentioned by a speaker in the last session as well. So I shouldn't really go into this, stay on this too much. What was discussed in December. One of the questions was lessons learned, talking about APEC, but our view is, that they're strongly committed to continuing engagement, but it's obvious that there's a period of reflection for the US due to the US elections. And of course, going forward, it's focuses on goods, but not just that, but also on identifying and addressing relevant barriers to trade and services. But I won't stress on that. Probably more detailed has been the work on bilateral. So we have trade agreements with Ukraine, Georgia, Moldova. They provided the template after work with future agreements. And they, as part of the Trade for All communication, have been kind of combined with the Singapore, Vietnam into kind of one big coherent package or template. So we're bringing all the things together. I'll show you in the next slide. But this will be the approach to negotiations. Well, the US is probably in the freezer or dormant or whatever you want to call it. But also upcoming Mexico, Australia, Indonesia, and there's several others and very important FTA negotiations. And if you want information on what this looks like, it's on our website. We sent some draft provisions in November for Mexico, and that can be found at the address there. And it pretty much looks like that, if you can see that. It's the focus with all our FTAs is if it can be horizontal and it goes in a horizontal chapter, that's better. So several of the issues that have risen in energy over the last number of years on energy and raw materials, like export restrictions, can be addressed sometimes horizontally, but some of them are very specific to energy and raw materials. So they're in four sections, and the ones highlighted in red are very relevant for green tech, The three in the bottom left-hand corner have been discussed at length today, but also the issues in the top right-hand corner are very important as well. If you want to invest in renewables in third countries, you need third-party access. You also have an issue with domestic regulated prices. If you can't get, if you can't sell your electricity, you know, or you can't, you know, it has knock-on effect. You can't get the loan to, and so on, and also issues to do with export pricing as well and monopolization. It's all bundled together into one package. So getting back to the topic of today, well, there was a lot discussed about FTA Singapore. So again, we discussed that there was this local contents, goods, services and investment, talking about performance requirements. We didn't talk about the access to networks, which is very much in there. It's not just about technologies and selling goods. It's also about investment as well, or selling electricity from renewables. And of course, as mentioned previously, the use of international standards as opposed to, you know, in the country in the specific. So it is in Vietnam and it will be in future FTAs. That's the plan anyway. And finally, on terms of enforcement, because it is quite important, and the Canadian case was mentioned, everybody knows it. And but also, we also look at enforcement because we have a very large aid budget in the EU. We provide a lot of assistance to third countries, but if, you know, a lot goes on to expenditure on energy, but if, you know, not where it's promoting local content requirements. So this is another tool that we use under enforcement as well. So I hope that gives you some new information that what you've heard through the day, and I guess I'll end there.
Thank you very much, Neil. So just two quick comments. One, you missed EU-Japan, for which we're looking forward to seeing the text whenever it comes out, and those new efforts, and then not just on the question of access to grid and connectivity. I think that there's a whole field there that we have also identified now, where it has to do with not only smart grid but also compatibility between grids and other issues that are related to regulatory frameworks that are not in place in many regions, to put it in that way, in the world, that are lacking there, but also many of which would have to do with investment conditions and would actually enable or not the expansion of clean energy technologies. I think as we move towards 2020 and 2030, it's the case of Switzerland. We didn't talk about it this morning, but Switzerland is struggling to find the clean energy sources, the supply that it would need, for instance, again, going into 2030, and it has identified that harvesting clean energy is perhaps the most obvious solution, and so harvesting clean energy somewhere else. For instance, in Iceland or in other places like that, right? And so again, those are issues that are going to become more and more important as well. I'll move immediately to René Bousinard. René is known to many people here. We have collaborated for about 27 years on issues related to all these topics, believe it or not. And René has authored several of the good analytical pieces, very specific on EGA negotiations and clean energy technologies that we have published in the past few years. And I'd say between René and Mahesh Sugathan, I don't think that anybody knows all the intimacies of clean energy technologies and trade as they do, they together do. So René, you get the floor.
Thank you, Ricardo, for your kind words, and thanks to ICTSD and WEC for inviting me to this meeting. I will talk about initiatives to reduce tariffs on environmental goods, particularly those that are list-based approaches. It was all mentioned several times, today, the APEC initiative of 2011 to reduce, by the end of 2015, applied tariff rates to environmental goods to 5% or less. These negotiations were completed in 2012 with the endorsement of the famous APEC list of environmental goods. It was then followed by a three-year implementation period by individual economies of the APEC regions. I'll talk about that a little bit. And then in the context of the EGA, the idea was that the APEC list would be the basis, but that in the course of the negotiations, additional renewable energy and energy efficiency technologies, together with other environmental technologies, would be considered and added. I would also like to mention that another agreement that has been mentioned today, the ITA expansion, ITA 2, is adding quite a lot of renewable energy and energy efficiency products. Can be found in the subheadings that are fully covered by ITA and ITA expansion. So these are being liberalized, they are being locked in. The APEC tariff commitment actually refers to products or national tariff lines that have a tariff rate, an applied tariff rate of over 5%, and are covered by the agreement. In the negotiating phase, APEC economies have decided which HS subheadings to include entirely and which with a subheading, with an X item. If there is an X, then countries are not obliged to implement full liberalization for the whole HS subheadings, but only for those national tariff lines that comply, that correspond with the X-outs that countries have decided. As you know, the implementation is always done at the national level and national tariff schedule of countries that participate. So instead of 2,210 tariff lines that the 54 APEC HS subheadings have in APEC economies that are obliged to implement tariff reductions, there are in fact only 520 that have an over 5% tariff. And of those, the countries have published that comparing those with the X-outs of the APEC list, only about 375 would have the obligation to reduce the tariff. There are 16 APEC economies mentioned here because there are five that didn't have any national tariff line with an over 5% tariff, which are Australia, New Zealand, Japan, Singapore, and Hong Kong, China. So with data from WTO, we can produce that list of 375 tariff lines that are part of the commitment. And then we go to the implementation, and we see that actually implementation has been done for almost all of them by now. Mostly in Korea, Brunei, Darussalam, which did it very early in the process. This implementation took the whole period of 2013 to 2015. Once a country decides that a tariff line level, that the tariff line is covered by the agreement with an over 5% tariff, it is required to take action on the tariff. And that can be done either by using existing tariff lines or, as has been done quite often, by splitting existing tariff lines or creating new tariff lines. In total, about 65 tariff lines, basically in Korea, Mexico, and China, have been reduced by creating new tariff lines, so as to have a more specific tariff reduction, which does not cover the whole tariff line, but a narrower description of the environmental technologies. So these have been almost all implemented. The only that has not yet been implemented is Indonesia's pending that they have 13 tariff lines that they have gradual reduction of tariff reduction until 2021. And Thailand has 7 tariff lines that they have reduced, but only to 7%. So that doesn't comply with the agreement. And then there's Chile is pending. Chile has a system that the whole tariff schedule of Chile has a 6% MFN rate of duty. Chile is committed to reduce those. At the end of 2015, the president sent a proposal to the Chamber of Deputies in Chile. They have now agreed to that. And the proposal was to reduce tariffs from 6 to 5% once legislation is implemented and all the way to zero by 2020. It has passed the Chamber of Deputies and now it is in the Senate in Chile. So this is pending. I took some tariff cuts for national tariff lines that are in the renewable energy efficiency sphere, particularly renewable energy. And put there some examples, for instance, in wind power generating sets, et cetera. And there are a number of countries mentioned there, economies, with the tariff that they had before implementation of tariff reductions. And you can see that they are quite substantive. You can also see that the way of implementation of those tariff reductions has been quite different by countries. Some have taken the existing tariff line, others have created a new tariff line, or have specified, for instance, the end use of the product, et cetera. But these are being have been implemented, and I would say they're quite substantive. Of course, there are free trade agreements, and these are applied rates, and in many cases the applied rate is lower or equal or zero. But nevertheless, I think as a result of the negotiations and the APEC tariff pledge, this is quite substantive. And that's why it gives some incentives to the environmental goods agreement. On that agreement, countries had decided when they launched the agreement in 2014 to build on the APEC list and to add additional technologies as far as possible with the relative value chains. And Jack and ICTSD have always made a lot of proposals to what products could be included. And as far as I know, at the end of last year, when negotiations were going fine, I think a lot of progress was made in adding new technologies to the APEC list. Some technologies were not mentioned at all in APEC, like hydro. Others were included, but with also only a limited coverage of the value chain. So a lot has been added, for instance, in wind energy and others as well, solar. And also the negotiators, with the help of customs officials, they have done quite a good job in creating fully implementable X-outs for products that are either multiple use or are parts or do not cover a whole subheading. Then one concern normally has been with the AGA that there was actually little export interest of developing countries to the markets of EGA countries. If you look into the imports of EGA in countries in 2015, only about 12% came from non-EGA countries. And these were basically in the solar sector of Malaysia and others, which have already duty-free rate, or the Mexico-US bilateral trade. But going into specific tariff lines that the United States has for wind components, you can see that at the level of specific tariff lines. In some of these developing countries, including non-EGA developing countries, have gained quite some share in US imports. I put there the average of 5 years because these data fluctuate a lot from 1 year to the other. But in wind turbines itself, it's quite low. I mean, almost all imports come from the EGA countries themselves. But in these components, you can find at faces at times quite substantive imports from non-EGA countries such as Brazil, India, Vietnam, Indonesia, and of course, Mexico. Then, as I already mentioned, the APEC list, if we take the imports in 2015 of the EGA participants, about a high percentage was already covered by the ITA. When it started, it had about 9 subheadings, in particular the solar cells and modules, which were already negotiated under the ITA. And it was also so that of the group of EGA participants, all had signed the ITA agreement. The same countries, the ITA 2 has also been signed by all EGA countries except Turkey, but Turkey has a bilateral agreement with the EU and applies the common external tariff of the EU, but of course in binding tariff it can be quite different. So I think you can see that a lot of progress has been made, a lot of progress is there to stay. For instance, what has been achieved in ITA 2 on energy efficiency and renewable energy products. And other initiatives can work along as well. The conclusions which I would have is that the APEC experience has been quite positive. It has covered only a small part of the APEC list. It's only products, tariff lines of 5% and an applied rate of more than 5%, which in terms of trade represents something like only about $35 billion rather than 200 and so much of the whole APEC list. But a lot of progress has been made in the APEC experience in clarifying issues related to exports, to national tariff lines, and other classification issues. So I think this leaves us with a good starting point to one day. Several people have said one day we're going to pick up again the EGA, and I hope this experience is useful in that context.
Thank you very much, René. Let's move immediately to Tadeusz Burns. And Tadeusz may be known to several of you either from his capacity before his current job with General Electric, with USTR and the Department of Commerce, now with General Electric for about 10 years, I understand. And he's a lead counsel on intellectual property and trade issues there. So, Tadeusz.
Thanks so much, Ricardo. Can everyone hear me? Just a quick question. How many of you are delegates here to the WTO who are either involved in the EGA negotiations or if you could just raise your hands, I'd love to. So there's a fair number of folks who've invested a lot of time in EGA over the last few years. Well, I understand what it feels like to be a little frustrated that things aren't moving faster. I remember when I was a delegate here, I was always really keen to show some kind of deliverables in the short period of time that I was assigned here, and these were not long assignments. And things don't move very fast in the multilateral world, unfortunately. I'd like to just share a couple thoughts about our thinking at GE as we engage in trade negotiations, particularly ones going on here at the WTO. I mean, obviously. And there was some discussion of ITA a little bit, and we were very active in ITA 2, very active in the environmental goods negotiations, as well as I think I've been to every COP from Copenhagen through Paris. And so as a company that invests a lot in clean technology or eco-imagination technologies, The recognition of climate change as a challenge and an enabling environment that encourages the uptake of renewables and more efficient older technology is very important to us as a company. But I think the biggest focus from our perspective is that on our customers, and in ITA it was really all about how can we get IT enabled medical technologies to our customers in those very fast growing markets, emerging markets, developing countries, at the lowest possible price, because price points are really important to people in that part of the world. And when I look at how we've invested in innovation within GE, I would say at least half of our investment in R&D relates to how do we do this for less? How do we take cost out of the manufacturing process? So how do we get the same functionality to a customer at a lower price, because price is critical to those communities? For ITA, that was very much part of our mindset. We were hugely encouraged to see entire product lines of ultrasound and CT and PET scans included in the revision to the ITA agreement. That's going to improve access to those technologies in all of those markets that signed on to our agreement, onto that agreement. The idea of an environmental goods agreement was something that we discussed coming out of a number of COP negotiations, where clearly the objective was absolutely, worthy. But I guess my reaction was these negotiations are moving so slowly, there must be an organization where we can operationalize policies that get clean technologies into the markets more quickly. And the WTO was very much the first thought when we were trying to figure out how do we save time, because time is really important here. So I think I was one of the first people to talk to Ambassador Punk about an environmental goods agreement, to suggest to him that let's get ourselves out of this sort of ongoing Doha discussion that doesn't seem to be going anywhere. Let's take on something that's manageable, that where we can get a group of countries that are really keen to make progress on this issue. And that's what happened. And it's for me, it was really uplifting to be part of ITA2 and to be part of the environmental goods negotiations as well. I felt things, were moving quickly. And we did make a tremendous amount of progress in a very short period of time. And there was an enormous amount of work by delegates here in Geneva and people coming in from Capitol over and over again to make progress, to bridge differences, to make sure that this remained an ambitious agreement and a zero tariff agreement above all, because I think there were some discussions about it not being a zero tariff agreement at some time. Look, I think there have been a lot of really interesting points. The delegate from Costa Rica gave some really interesting insight into the sort of the history of plurilaterals and how they can deliver really concrete results, and also the linkage with the COP negotiations. And frankly, ICTSD as well, and the World Energy Council, we have been working in parallel on these issues for a very long time. I think that we were in Russia together for the APEC meeting. I don't recall how many years ago that was now, but we made a lot of progress and got to a really good place in December, where we had an ambitious list that everybody had agreed to, except for one of the negotiators. And that was regrettable that there wasn't a consensus and that we could not have said, this is the agreement, and then passed on to the next administration something to ratify. I think I recall that at least in the Uruguay round, the negotiations took place over, and the ratification took place, straddled two different administrations. That's an easier situation to contemplate than where we are right now. So I guess a couple of ideas about how to make sure that we don't lose momentum, because I think momentum is very important in these kinds of situations. We are, as the U.S. business community, are working very hard to make sure that we signal to the administration the paramount economic importance of the environmental goods agreement for U.S. industry, that there are a lot of jobs and a lot of prosperity linked to market opportunities for the very broad tech, the list of products that we arrived at in December, that there are a lot of offensive interests there that, yes, this is about climate change, but maybe we don't talk too much about climate change as we engage with our current leaders in Washington. I think they're very much focused on communities in the U.S. that had previously worked in manufacturing and haven't done very well over the last 8 years. And I think it's not too difficult to make it clear that EGA is part of the solution for these communities and building out manufacturing again. In the European Union in particular, I think it's pretty clear that a very favorable regulatory environment for clean technology and renewables has made this a very important offensive interest for the European Union, an export interest. So, just in terms of, and by the way, I didn't know that Jim Baker was someone who was much involved in climate policy, but apparently he has just come up with a carbon tax proposal, which comes out of left field in a way. So there is some thinking going on here about how to deal with climate change and what the policies ought to be, both in Washington and here in Geneva. But we're going to do our best working with the NFTC and our trade associations in the U.S. I think in China we did a good job peeling back the important export interests that China had in such an agreement through an economic study. It's like when you have a new boss and you've got a new guy who's running the show, and he says, well, what are you doing, Mr. Burns? What is it you've been spending your time on? And sometimes you have to come up with new explanations for something that was kind of an article of faith under your previous boss. And I think that the environmental goods negotiations were an article of faith under the Obama administration. And we do need to do a better job explaining the numbers, the benefits to U.S. workers in the U.S. For this agreement. And so we are going to do that. But I think there's some other opportunities as well. There are a lot of people who've been watching the discussions from the sidelines. And to create some momentum, it might be interesting to see some other countries joining the negotiations officially. Mexico, for example, could take on that leadership role. Or Chile, important free traders who are very influential in this space. So I think there's an opportunity for us all to push to get these negotiations, I won't say back on track, because I think this is a pause. They are not off track at this point. Another point is, as your very senior government officials are in Washington, please talk to the president about this issue. Make it clear that this is a priority for you. And I think that we're going to be able to get this on the priority list of this administration. After all, it's not a multilateral agreement, it's a plurilateral agreement. So thanks for your attention. Appreciate it.
Good. Thank you, Tadeusz. That's a good pitch for the end of the day.